My name is Stephanie Harman. I am from Stanford. I'm one of the palliative care docs there, and I'm director of palliative care service. And I also co-chair our hospital ethics committee. So I end up spending a lot of my time in communications work. And Josh Frommel is one of our other palliative care faculty, who is also medical director of our outpatient, career care-based palliative care clinic. And is also a palliative care physician on the inpatient side as well. So, in any case, to say a little bit about this session, so we're not going to spend a ton of time actually in kind of this, staring at PowerPoint deck kind of format, really just to give you some of our basic talking points that we've been using for discussing goals, and I'm really trapped, so a lot of this has come from both Josh's and my training with the group that is currently known as Vital Talk, formerly known as OncoTalk. So the primary investigators for that group, primary faculty that developed curricula and teaching communication around kind of challenging conversations. So those current people are Tony Bach from University of Washington, the GI oncologist, James Tulski at Duke, who directs their palliative care center there, Bob Arnold at the University of Pittsburgh, who's also directs their palliative care program and medical ethics program, and Kelly Frere Edwards, who has actually a PhD with a specialization in healthcare communication. So both Josh and I have gone through their kind of approach to practicing, training, developing skills in communication teaching. So they're also a group that's developed a curriculum called NephroTalk. So you'll see a couple references to that. That is actually explicitly designed for kind of discussions in nephrology, dealing with kind of difficult topics. Things like dialysis, initiation of dialysis, cessation of dialysis, discussing goals of care in the context of chronic kidney disease. So, with that.
You said this premier, the group is premier something?
So the group is, the best way, it's the current iteration of the group they've developed, because they have so many, there's like OncoTalk, PalliTalk, GeriTalk, NephroTalk, all these different variations. The one site to go to is vitaltalk.org. I referenced it in our slides, and it is a great resource for kind of talking maps for different difficult conversations. As generic as dealing with conflict, to as specific as discussing prognosis. Great set of resources there. Josh and I are both involved in medical ethics at Stanford, so represent disclosure slide. We have no financial disclosures, no one pays us to talk about this at all. Thinking about just this next, basically 10 to 12 minutes, we're going to go through relatively briefly a framework. This is just one framework for discussing goals. Goals of care in the context of dialysis. So this is, again, kind of gleaning material from some of the resources that I've already mentioned, kind of thinking about what are the practical communication tasks that you're doing through that process. And then what we'll do in the breakout, the reason we have smaller numbers for each breakout group is that we have simulated patients who are going to be joining us so that we can actually practice through these conversations in a setting where this is the place to kind of try out things. And I will also say, with these kinds of kind of communication maps, talking maps, you all are experienced clinicians. You all have the talking maps that you use in your head. And what I would say is that just like when, if you're like a musician or an athlete and you get told about some new grip for your tennis stroke to get more topspin, you're fine, you've been playing tennis the way you've been playing tennis. And you learn a new grip, you're gonna kind of feel de-skilled for a little while, using this new grip. But the idea is that you'd have another set, another tool kind of in your armamentarium about an approach that you could use with your, in your tennis match or whatever. But I fully expect that some of this is gonna feel a little weird, especially in kind of trying it out with a simulated patient. And so, you know, embrace it. Like, feel, you know, feel free to try out things. This is kind of a place that, you know, we all kind of practice in this kind of arena. So, in any case, that's kind of a caveat before we talk a little bit more about this. So, just thinking about communication, I don't know if you all feel like this. We feel like this a lot. single biggest problem with communication is the illusion that it is taking place. Oh yes, you know, Asian family, they totally get it. You know, and then suddenly, like, different behaviors or sudden choices, you're like, well, maybe not. and so, you know, what you've said and what they've heard can be different things, and how do we actually have tools to make sure that we're ensuring that our patients and families are informed and attended to in terms of both their kind of cognitive needs as well as their kind of emotional, spiritual, psychological needs. So, question for you all. So what are kind of the common barriers that you all perceive, especially in your clinical practice, to effective communication? So, yes.
Language.
Can you say more about that?
So I have a lot of Vietnamese speaking patients, and it is so hard and sometimes so frustrating on my part because I am not quite sure, is the family member really translating correctly? Is the patient actually getting what I want to convey? I always feel that something is always lost in the translation. And you just can't communicate, and it's really one of the biggest things.
So language and patients who have limited English. Anyone else have similar challenges with those kinds of patients that have languages?
I get a lot of my work on it, so you don't get as much. I don't have any life discussions on the phone, but I do a lot of my work on the phone. I recommend I check the advanced healthcare directives because it's in my computer, and if it's not correct, I recommend to get another one or talk to them about going to a class or something. But if there's something very different on the phone, than if you had the opportunity to talk to them in person.
Right. Yeah, no, it's, you know, there's definitely different levels of data that you're able to glean from face to face conversation,
right.
Phone, or something written.
It's like all the non-verbal and not.
Yeah. Actually, I think there's probably, I don't know if folks in this room probably had really difficult conversations over the phone or sometimes about necessities. And it's actually, there could be a whole other workshop in terms of how to do that. Or even delivering kind of devastating news over the phone. I mean, that process is something that I think a lot of clinicians
experience. The doctors sometimes get bad news on the phone. They have biopsy results and they have to tell them. So instead of, you know, having them come in to talk about their options or whatever, sometimes they tell them on the phone. So that's always hard to hear, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah. Anything else? Other barriers?
Yes. Well, I think as a consumer, just lack of time. Sometimes when I go in to see my physician at Kaiser, I know this has limited time. He can be kind of rich. What's going on? So there's just a lack of time. So I think from a consumer's point of view, how can I communicate quickly to get it out? There's some people that might have language problems or cognitive abilities. I don't know how to do that.
Some of our geriatric population, some of them are pretty hard of hearing. And sometimes they're not going to hear everything that you said, and that could easily be misconceived.
Certainly, and then there's the time. Time is a huge issue, right? Like, it's hard to imagine. And we'll have to address that somewhat in the breakout groups, because when you're in these simulations, they're going to feel like they're taking forever. When if you're in that seat as a clinician working with the simulated patient, but you know, actually, some of these conversations don't necessarily have to be very extensive, but it is about kind of the different channels you're working on, both a cognitive channel and emotional channel, and which one is dialed up, and how can you get back to, you know, whichever channel you think you need to reattend to. Other things?
More?
I go in with the get up here and I get something else from the patient. So sometimes you just have to be aware of that and kind of don't come with our plan and that's the plan done. Yeah. But perceive and listen to the
patient. People who are psychotic.
Yes.
That's what I have to do a lot. No, patients for a second.
And then there is another
story. I know.
So, yeah, I just wanted to get to know some, basically some thoughts out there in here about what we really do deal with on a regular basis and the communication, and especially with your patient population, geriatric, chronically ill, you know, patient family in different roles or understandings of the plan. So this is kind of an overall map of what we think about for urgent care. This came out of this NephroTalk curriculum that again is something that I can see this applying to other discussions, not necessarily just in nephrology, but the idea of kind of thinking about what the patient understands of their disease stage. You know, what does it mean to have an isolation for CKD versus something else? So what does it mean that you're on the verge of dialysis, et cetera? Expecting emotion, you know, just planning for it. And then addressing the uncertainty about prognosis. So, you know, organ failure is a very different type of prognosis than metastatic cancer. The trajectory is different. The slope of that line is very different for someone who's dying from metastatic cancer, you know, versus heart failure or kidney failure. And then thinking about big picture values and goals and how do we elicit that, different strategies for that, and making a recommendation to the patient and the family and how to do that with support to help our support to patients. So a couple of tools that we'll talk about in the breakouts a little more, but just to give you a sense of, again, you're probably using tools like this. You have your own tools and go-tos that you use in terms of phrases, scripts, etc. So the first is ask, tell, ask, which is something that we use a lot in shared decision making. It's really just its own kind of entity around how do you assess understanding, fill in gaps, and then check in about how does that sit with the patient, what does that mean for the patient, and then thinking about emotion. We like this acronym NURSE, which is essentially naming emotion, understanding sort of the print is really tiny, different techniques in terms of statements and responses to emotion that you can make. The idea is not that this is to be scripted or inauthentic, but to actually figure out like kind of, you know, what potentially might help transition and attend to that patient's emotional state so that they can process and move on to something else. Whether it's naming the emotion, understanding, expressing understanding of where their emotion is coming from, respecting, which generally means praising. So sometimes this is often for patients that we see who are patients and families that we may actually fundamentally would recommend against potentially the choices that they're making, but that they're clearly dedicated. That you're aligning with them, you express praise for kind of, you know, their behavior, their dedication, their relationships, etc., and then supporting them, which I usually equate with non-abandonment in terms of that principle and how to express that, and then exploring further. Tell me more about kind of what you're thinking right now and how you're feeling right now. Seems like you're frustrated. Does that sound about right? Ask, tell, ask. So this is also really hard to see. It's, again, I think about this as kind of one unit of when you're thinking about a chunk of information. You want to make sure they understand, or that you have to fill in the gaps on, and then kind of circling back to make sure that they have an understanding that aligns with what yours is. So I'm not going to spend too much time on the rest of these slides. These are really just going through kind of what the steps are. When I say understanding, this is kind of what we're thinking about, looking at the patient's understanding, recognizing it's wrong to emotion. So this one step is really not necessarily you know, in sequence. It's more something that's going to be happening across the continuum of these kinds of conversations. It often comes out when you're discussing goals that suddenly you have to address and reframe the status quo, or the status quo has changed. And that's really in and of itself the task of breaking bad news. And so oftentimes, even when you're just filling in gaps of information, that's new bad news for the patient in all the dealing with emotions. And then thinking about prognosis, I think one of the biggest strategies is around figuring out how they like information and what would be helpful for them. Because some patients really like numbers, like our engineers and whoever, they want the stats, and others are like, doc, just tell me what the best case scenario is, what's the worst, what do you think is the most likely thing that's gonna happen? And so to figure out how people receive information, you know, people hear 80% chance of dying from a procedure versus 20% chance of surviving and living from a procedure, they'll make different decisions hearing both of those things. And so you're thinking about how to give people this comprehensive view. But listening big pictures, really this section is really about asking the open-ended questions that are directed around future and what's valuable for them. Mm-hmm. So we think about quality of life, we think about kind of their functioning, and we think about like their outlook on the future. And so two flip sides of this same question around like what are you hoping for as you look to the weeks, years ahead, or what are you most afraid of? And so flip sides of the same coin, but it can often elicit the values. And getting a statement from a patient that you can hang your hat on and say, here's the treatment plan that I'm going to recommend that will align best with what you just told me. And so that last step is about making the recommendation and formulating a plan. I think about, especially in this population, you know, dialysis, the question comes up around, you know, if we were to stop, you know, what are the sorts of the concerns that you may have or questions, et cetera, and to be a little more proactive around these kind of fears, concerns. I will say also with regards to making a recommendation, you know, I think about, I know this is kind of a very crude metaphor, but you know, if I take my car into the mechanic, like, I don't want the menu. I want to say, I just want you to get this fixed. It doesn't have to be, you know, it can be not so fancy, but it has to last me through such and such time. What do you think I should do? I don't want to hear about, you know, I can put this kind of transmission in plus this, and I can do this or this, and you get to pick. I want the mechanic who actually is done working cars way, way longer than me to make a recommendation based on what. Okay, I'm willing to pay this price. I'm willing to do this. I don't have to buy a new car, et cetera. And so similarly, the idea of imparting a recommendation for patients and families is, I think, a really particular way to support them, because they're often feeling like, I am choosing between life and death. I'm a person who's not a medical person, and I don't know how to pick. But there's often this expectation, you know, this sense of patient autonomy that means the menu, that means that they can just pick whatever they, you know, looking at a screen of different things. And really, that menu, it's not really any different than someone going to a computer and entering data and then seeing a list of different menu options. And so the clinician's expertise, that mechanic, is really valuable in that relationship and being able to impart recommendation. So with that, I'm going to stop here. We're going to move into the small groups, and actually, and so we don't interrupt Dr. Kinnerman's presentation. We're just going to actually sneak around back through here through the cafe, and then we'll head out there around to get to the breakout rooms. But to think about, we're going to get a case. This is Misty Wilmot. So you'll meet a woman with chronic kidney disease who is on dialysis. She's been in dialysis for some years. She's got multiple medical problems, hypertension, diabetes, probably folks, sounds fairly common amongst the patients you see. And to think about, you don't have to say out loud about now, but thinking about, is there are specific skills you want to work on or specific sections of this kind of conversation that you are interested in? trying out practicing, et cetera, as you're going into the small groups. And we'll try, from that standpoint, to direct kind of the times when you're in that practicing seat to sections of the conversation or communication that relate directly to what you're interested in terms of your goals. Okay.